shades of color. We have been told if we are dog dog, we are really not, we don't matter. As you get lighter, that means you fit into society. Society tends to look at you different when you're skinner, dog, because we've been made to believe that. And another is that pigmentation. And that skin that determines if we're going to be light, dark, or in between, or maybe some of us are called two-tone. We have different shades. We have light portions and we have dark portions.
I know melanin is what gives me the beautiful shade I have.
Melanin, tan 1 and 2, and scientists have found out they are trying to, I think it's an injection or something that can give you that last 3 to 4 weeks where you will, well, I guess people of non-color will want to be like a dark, you know, keep their tan year round, and now they do this melanin, tan 1 and 2. It's interesting, you know, that we look at each other and we divide ourselves and they want to know non-color, like dark, light. But then other people are non-color, they want to be this way.
Just based on what I've read, we want to be careful about saying that people have no melanin, because all people have melanin. It's just that the level that they have differs from person to person.
I also think that a lot of us that once let our darkness cause a problem, we learn to deal with our different shades, and we learn to appreciate it in a type of way that makes us proud of ourselves. Even if we are darkness, we use the word darkness as fading. We learn to look at ourselves and see our beauty inside of us that each of us that possess that has. So it really, we learn to deal with it on a different level. Melanin determines a lot about how the way we act. And I posted that long about as far as religion go. Does that make a person feel a shout? Does it make a person react? Give them a sort of like an inner strength?
I think it gives us a higher level of energy.
Because as a whole, you know, people of color, we are spiritual people. So melanin that we have within us can help us get more in tune with ourselves.
They just have a psychological effect on our minds at the same time? Yes, really.
Participatory in their worship.
to maintain it. They do it automatically. I think that's a lot reason why.
Slave owners various things that date far back into why we have this, you know, priority reflection toward melanin, as opposed to melanin being something that is an attribute and a boon to our society, as opposed to just being something negative.
It's interesting that you should mention that, because Dr. Frances Quest Walton mentions in her book, The Isis Papers, how white people envy us because of our level of melanin. What does anybody have to say about that?
Well, that kind of goes to zero and intense lines.
We're not proud of our color, but we have people who envy us because of our color.
So. They don't want to be us, but they want to look like us.
Right.
And that seems to be a hypocritical standpoint.
I think,
what's her name? Diana.
Diana was, had mentioned earlier that they're using injections of melanin in order to gain that color also.
That's why I believe that's why we as a people should be proud of who we are and proud of our complexion, and never try to add anything to take away from it or to add anything to it. You should just be proud to be black, because it's beautiful. That's what I feel. And I notice that now a lot of people are recognizing and being able to identify themselves and accept themselves for who they are. And once we can do that as a race, as a group of people of color, once we can accept ourselves and accept that we are beautiful, regardless to what shade of black we are, you know, then we can really need to understand our beliefs. And a lot of people of color are not proud to be of color. You have a set of people who are not of color and they try to be like us, you know?
So it's like the 90s being black or being a person of color is a fad now.
Oh,
I would hope that fad would evolve into some type of self-education, so that one, when you look at something, when you hear something, you don't know the history of the author. You're not going to know exactly what it is he's talking about. You might agree with what he's saying, but you have to know what he's talking about in its essence. So you're going to have to take it upon yourself to research exactly what it is he's saying, so you can get a better understanding of why he's presenting it to you in that particular fashion. We have people that represent us in political forums and other forums. Some come across as fiery speakers, some come across as laid back. You wonder why there's such a dichotomy with the way they're presenting the same issue. It's all a matter of how they're taking their approach, what type of research they've done, what their opinions on and certain things are, and how we as people either come together or go apart regarding what these opinions are.
Good afternoon, my name is Palani Franklin. I have a comment 7 years old, I was in a swimming pool with about 50 children, and I was the only person of color in that pool. Now, as I was swimming, this young boy came up to me, and he told me, he said, "Why don't you get out of the pool?" And I said, "Why?" He said, "Because you're going to turn the water brown, you know?" Like that. So that during that time, I felt really bad about the fact that I had color. And for a long time, I thought I was ugly, and I thought I wasn't good enough because of that. And I stayed calm, and I didn't do anything before. But I'd just like to say that I think this whole conference is a really great idea, because now children of color don't have to grow up feeling so bad because of the fact that they have color. They can feel very proud and know the melanin in their skin and what it does for them. And very proud of it.
Exactly.
Sure.
What was the first thing that went through your mind when you said
that? That I was ugly, that I was something terrible. I felt really bad, shied away. And for a long time, I mean, until I was 14, 15 years old, I thought that something was wrong with me because I was so dark. And it wasn't until I became an adult and I read that I felt very proud to be dark. And the question that I have is in reference to shades of color. And that is, do light-skinned blacks have less melanin than dark-skinned blacks?
That's what would dictate the shade, the concentration of melanin within the system. It's going to dictate whether your black complexion or complexion or
trouble in society.
reach out to you and explain the difference to them so that when they go out there to the real world, you know how to confront them.
Let me ask you a question. As an educator, do you find that with today's Afrocentricity just enveloping everyone, are these kids taking it as just a thing to do, or are they making a serious effort to learn about why they are who they are?
I think that some of the students, if it's important at home and they have parents who are really, you know, Afrocentric, which they use that word for, that it follows through more. Whereas, because some of the kids, I think that at the age level that they are, the only thing that they're worried about is fitting in and being accepted. So if it's the acceptable thing to be pro-black, then they're being pro-black. But I don't think that a lot of them really understand the concept, and they don't really know their roots and their heritage. And, you know, I think that they're trying, though, because we were one of the schools who actually took the day off and took all the students to see Malcolm X on the first day. And when they came back, they were all, you know, really geared up, and they were talking about it. And, you know, we were trying to follow up classroom discussions and things like that. And it was something that the kids were really into. So the interest is there, and the kids are really there, and, you know, they really want to do it. And if you have educators and parents at home who are enforcing it, I think it would be sincere. But a lot of it is just superficial fitting in.
Do they have a medium by which they can express any of these interests or ask questions regarding it?
Yes, they do.
Good thing is when you come into the school at a young age, because you're the ones who see this class at a young age, they'll pass it on.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Naftali Jefferson. I am from West Africa, Liberia. Now, my purpose of come up is to talk, to give you guys something that happened to me in high school when I first came to this country. During my sophomore to my junior year, I had some friends that who was a black friend who used to diss me because of my own color. They used to call me Chaku. They used to diss me from where I'm from. That from Africa was I used to like jump from trees to tree, you know, says things that they don't know much about. So like my purpose is before you be proud of your own color, you shouldn't make fun of your other people because of where they're from. Don't make fun of other colors. And learn where you're from, your roots. Alright? Otherwise I don't think you should be proud of your own color. Don't make fun of the African, don't say anything stupid. So that's how I came up with it, because it seemed like a lot of Americans, black Americans kids in this country don't know really where they're from. All they think because they're black, that means they're black and beautiful. Of course, you should be proud, you're black and beautiful. But if you think you're black and beautiful and you're making fun of other people, you're no lower than the white people, all right? That's how I say it, lower than the white people.
But you have to keep in mind also that a lot of people that they react like this is because they don't know better. You know, like a lot of people, like you said, they would make fun about your complexion and where you come from. There may be a small percentage of people that really believe the concept that during slavery time, we all originated in Africa, and during slavery time was spread. A lot of people indoctrinated to believe because I'm from here, this is what I am, but they don't understand the past history in order for them to understand the present, have to understand the past. So some people, because they're ignorant and they don't want to go beyond that, that's why they react like that. Because you said, like, you should be proud of it. I mean, of course you should be proud of your country.
I am proud where I'm from.
A lot of people that were making fun of you, perhaps, they reacted like that because of the fact that they have no knowledge because they're ignorant. That's why I think it's important for people that do have knowledge to just keep on spreading, you know, to touch those that have no knowledge of it.
not Jamaican, you've gotten even in more reality, we are all the same people of color, because he's from Trinidad, she's from Guyana, I'm from Panama, she's from Queens, and we all go to Bensonhurst. They're not going to say, no, don't mess with him, mess with her. They're going to look at all of us as the same. So that's something that we have to address among ourselves, the race of people. A lot of people, they're lost and confused, and they contempt what's handed down to them. They don't want to research and go beyond that.
Also, there's one thing I want to say. And for us to work together as blacks, we must be friends. Otherwise, we will never work together, and the white man will always be ahead of us, no matter what. Excuse me, may I ask what you're laughing for? Does it sound correct? Why are you laughing? Where I said what? Because my accent. So we laughing. Exactly. It's a point right there. He just made a point. No. That's definitely the point. Where I came from, as a child, you start to be, you know, we are disciplined. I'm serious. Where I came from, discipline is the key word. All right. Like they have. If your parents are talking, your child has to be talking. If you do that, your mother will spank you so much that able to sell your ass. That's what makes me mad. When I see kids doing things now, it makes me extremely mad. Now, like, I'm not staying longer. I plan to go back to Africa. I definitely plan to go back to Africa because I don't like this country. Okay, huh? Yeah, you're right on that.
Let's keep it on the right track.
Right.
If you have a political or emotional difference.
No, I don't have a political
emotion. What we're here to do is to talk about melanin and try to spread some ideas so that these people can take it unto themselves to research who they are. We're not trying to put across any type of disrespect or to voice any political views, whereas why you like the country, why you don't like the country.
True.
I appreciate your comments, but you have to also respect what we're trying to do here.
And I do, I certainly do. I'm glad you guys invited these people to talk about how they should be proud of blackness, because blackness is all there is. We are beautiful.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hotep, my name is Fahima Seth, and I'm a part of the student roundtable. I apologize for being late, but I had some other pressing matters that I had to attend to. I only caught the tail end of what was going on, but I gather we were talking about our diversity and also our common ground. And we all, as people of color, come from various parts of the diaspora, and as the sister, I heard her say that, you know, when we go into neighborhoods and we are confronted with institutionalized racism, they don't necessarily look at, well, you're from this place, you're from that place. They see us, basically what I'm trying to say, if our oppressors see us as one, we should see ourselves as one.
My name is Jeanette, and I have two comments. One is basically on the levels of skin color. Sitting down, I've heard a lot about differences in how dark skins are treated as opposed to light skins, and as you can see, I'm very light skinned. And what occurred to me was that the other side was not brought out until like very recently. Someone came up here and said something. Growing up, I come from a Latin background, and growing up, I encountered a lot of not fitting in and not belonging because I was quote unquote not black enough, or what was I? And one of the things that I've learned through melanin and stuff is understanding that there's a variety, it's like a rainbow, you know, from the lightest light to the darkest that dark, and your skin color on the outside does not determine the level of how black you are. And one of the things that concerns me is that as a people, we bought into the stereotypes and we bought into all of the negativity that the oppressors have told us about ourselves. So now we perpetuate. See, we don't have to be in chains anymore to be enslaved. We do it to ourselves now. No one has to whip us because we whip ourselves. And I see that happening a lot with the children, and it concerns me because they're our future. I have a lot of faith and a lot of belief in that our children are going to be the ones that are going to change things for us, but I think that it's important for us to stop focusing on the outside and who looks like what or whatever, because that's irrelevant. It's who and what you are within yourself. And I think that as an adult, it's important for us to embrace all of our children in all colors and let each and every one of them know that they are all black, that they are all equally, you know, African Americans, and that the outside is just the cover. And another thing that I wanted to talk about was the fact that I find that more or less the conversation is being focused on what the problems are already, you know, the skin color problems and the problems that you have in being black or whatever, but we're not focusing on the fact that there's something real positive that's come up in this conference, which is the fact that as black people, we have this melanin in us, and that this is affording us, or that we're finding out that this is telling us that there's something about us as a people that's special. We have something that's special within us that we need to embrace. We have, if I'm understanding correctly, I think melanin affects the intellect and your ability to learn. If I'm hearing it correctly, it's that it has the ability to retain the knowledge, and I think that has something to do with light or whatever. So it may not necessarily make us smarter, because I think we need to be real careful when we start doing what our oppressors have done. We're better than. I don't think that that's the issue. I think the issue is that we are a good people, that we are an intelligent people, that what we've been told and how we've been treated is not so, that we do have abilities that are unique to us as a people, and that we need to focus on that and enhance those things about us that are special so that we can find something about ourselves that we can hold on to that can raise the self-esteem. So I get kind of concerned when I hear children, because I hear it a lot with children, and I know that it comes from the fact that we're sick and tired as adults, we're sick and tired of where we've been to, so we're going through the opposite extreme. But I am concerned with kids growing up, so now kids oppress people that are different because it's sort of like paybacks. I think that we need to teach our children to focus on themselves, on what's good about themselves, to feel good as being African Americans, and to grow up and to teach their children so that the cycle changes. And that's my thought.
Did you ask them why they made fun of your skin color?
out there and just give us an example?
Cedric Andrews. I'm from a small island in the Caribbean called St. Vincent. And I have, as you can see, I have an accent. So I went through all the harassment and all the other ridicule. I have a friend from Ghana. He's lighter than, as this little girl in the front, she's as light as her. And he gets the same joke about jumping from tree to tree and all that nonsense. And me, as a black man, when I'm out there with my other brothers, I try to teach them, I try to educate as much as I can. And sometimes it hurts me because it's like there's no response from them. And I can remember nighttime in my bed crying because I'm tired of the stuff that's going on in my neighborhood. Brothers on the corner smoking weed every day, not going to school, not doing anything with their lives. And a big part of it with the color barrier, I don't blame you kids as much because as our parents and our foreparents before them, was taught by the white man and the enslavers that anything close to white is better. So they, from generation to generation, taught that to their kids, that anything, even a lighter pigmentation in their skin is better. So from that, our kids learn. That's why I came up into it, because it's not true. We're all black.
And
we're all gonna stay black.
Can I ask you a question? You said you're from St. Vincent?
Yes.
What is it like over there, whereas within the black community?
Exactly. In that country, there's no question about white and black, because the black is, there's no white in the government, there's no, it's a black-run country.
Right.
So there's no race. racial tension or anything of that sort.
So you're saying that even within the shades of black, there's no animosity, no stereotype, no stigmatism related to saying, well, I'm darker than you, or you're lighter than I, there's some favoritism?
It is, in a sense, because there's a few light complexion people, so they'll call them pigs, and they'll call them this and that, and you know, in that sense there is, but there's a very few of them.
So which one is more dominant?
The black, without the complexion.
The darker ones, whereas, are getting, and if you're going to look at, he got the job because he's either light or dark, which one is the job?
In that sense, in that part. The kid, and like, if you're a kid, you'll debate and stuff like that.
So
no, that's not good. And the next thing is, like, if in my country, because like all black, we never really think about, and we think of the white man, as, oh, he's so great. Oh, we see it on television, we have television and all that. So we see the white image, we see the neighborhoods with the mailbox in front and the big green lawn, and everybody wanna come to America because that's their vision of America. You understand? So they wanna come to America. And when they get to America, they have all this. And we understand, we're two different people with two different cultures trying to coexist. We are living in their society by their religion and their rules. We are people of African descent. We do not have their culture. We do not believe in their beliefs. As somebody was saying the other day, one of my teachers, like Dr. Spock or some European doctor, he says, when your baby cries, you leave it alone. But in Africa, they have pouches around them to keep their baby close to them, to keep their children close to them, to give them love. That's one of the big problems. As a race, we're trying to coexist with the next race. That's why I believe sincerely in the teaching of Marcus Garvey.
All right, but where is color is concerned? How is that affected, say, when you're bringing up your child? Is there any favoritism put?
No, in my family there isn't.
Well, not necessarily your family, but you would be able to speak on it with more of an authority than I would, where it's coming from St. Vincent. I can't speak for St. Vincent since you can't.
Oh, you're talking about St. Vincent?
Right.
No, there isn't. Your color doesn't really have anything to do with what you do there.
I am from a Jamaican background. Mm-hmm.
But in Jamaica, there's a lot of white influence.
Well,
there's a lot of white influence in Jamaica.
But it's
not that way.
Just across the border, there's Barbados. And y'all think on the same level. Right?
Because Barbados is more industrialized than St. Vincent. We are still, you could call it maybe a third world country.
I appreciate your pride in it, because I think you might have a little of a blinder over your eye, whereas what's actually going on.
Maybe I do.
You might have only been exposed to an isolated situation as opposed to the entire thing.
Right, that's possible. It's very possible.
Thank you for coming.
Peace. I'd like to ask the elders for permission to speak. Yes, I was looking at some of the literature that was handed out, and it was very interesting. And a lot of the information represented on melanin by the scientists, like Nobles and Dr. Richard King, Cress Wilson, it doesn't speak as much to the outer significance of color as much as it speaks to the inner realities of energy, which is really, I think, that we have to be a little bit more focused upon. It's not so much the color thing that's been blown out of proportion for a lot. African people have had many different colored varieties throughout the continent for thousands of years before European intervention. And that was because of their diet, that was because of their environment, and perhaps some other things that we're not aware of physiologically. I know when in the handout, in the Introduction to African Psychology, there's one page I think that we need to read and reread and study about on page 15, what is the mystery of melanin? And on page 16 about melanin and the central nervous system. Going through those chapters, I think that we'll be able to glean the most information from on the whole concept of melanin. Today in scientific circles is basically debating about the use of melanin to enhance your awareness of not what you see but what is invisible to the eye. You know, we know that different birds and animals, they have a lot more awareness of states of consciousness and energy fields that we're not aware of by the ear, by the eye. They say that the human eye is very limited in what it can conceive and what it can see. The human ear only notes a certain auditory cycle or levels that is a much larger expanse of hearing that we're not aware of. This all moves into the whole rhythmic flow of melanin. Melanin is supposed to increase your awareness of what is invisible to your eye and what's inaudible to your ear. This speaks to trance states, which were very usable in Africa to protect the tribe, an awareness of things that were to come, an awareness of things that happened centuries beyond. It was all tied in not merely to the melanin in the upper levels of the skin, but the melanin that was inside the heart, the melanin that was inside the ear, inside the eyes, inside the third eye area, which is right above and between your eyebrow. So I say for all the younger people in the audience, you can begin in the mornings to massage this area between and above your eyebrows. For males, you can move it towards the right, and for females, you can rotate towards the left. Just to increase the amount of blood that circulates in that area. This area in Africa was called the third eye. And a lot of times in the hieroglyphics, you'll see a snake or a cobra coming out of that area. You realize that the snake comes up the spinal cord through the divide of the brain into that area. They're just telling you there's different areas in the spinal cord, different glands that secrete melanin also, and that have as a nucleus melanin. They have as a nucleus black pigment. But also in the article, they talk about different types of melanin, different colors of melanin, and their responses to different planets, influences, vibrations. Because I know as women will know that they are linked up to the moon in terms of its cycles of change. That you also feel changes within your body. And they say males, men, for the most part, are linked up to the cycles of change in the moon and the sun also. So I think that we need to really concentrate on the effects of melanin on the areas that are not so obvious, which has always been our forte as Africans, has always been our spirituality, our ability to tap into the energy that today Europeans are tapping into themselves. I mean, if you watched Bill Moyes' program on Channel 13, recently, where they investigated the knowledge of China in terms of their meditation, their martial arts, their healing practices, is all tied into things that you can't see when your eyes are open, but what you can see when your eyes are closed. Even Africans said that before there was light, that the light was born out of the darkness. And you have to realize that melanin is just one of a dual chemical reaction. There's melanin and there's serotonin. Serotonin and melanoma are reacted together. One in the presence of light, sunlight, and also synthetic light, man-made lights, but one that's reacted in the presence of darkness, starlight. So you have melanoma and serotonin. Melanoma is the one that's...
Melatonin,
is serotonin. So serotonin is produced with the onset of light, with dawn, awakening of the sun, but at darkness, the melatonin is produced from your glands. It's supposed to produce higher states of trances of dreams, the ability to understand the symbols that you react to during the day. Now, another sister came up and said that your cells absorb light, and at night time is when the light's supposed to be released, and then you try to make awareness of it, consciousness of it, because the Africans also felt that not only was everything that we say a symbol of some hidden knowledge, but also everybody that you see, everything, every color, every shape, whether it be geometrical, scientifical, or mathematical, that is supposed to teach you something. Now, for the most part, we're distracted because of the color thing, because of the male-female relationship thing, because of the racism thing. So we're not always thinking and dwelling upon the shapes, the energy, our breathing, which is another integral part of the whole process of melanin, is the fact that you release melanin more and more when you're conscious of releasing it, and when you're conscious of your breathing rhythms, which is supposed to heal your glands along your spinal cord. What I would like to do is I like to offer some exercises that almost everybody here can do in the morning, in the afternoon, and at night. What you can begin to do is be aware of your spinal cord and try to make it a lot more straighter. Try to make sure that your head and your neck and the bottom part of your spine are somewhat lined up. You can always line yourself up with a stick or a wall. Try to make sure that your spine is completely vertical, completely straightforward, straight up. You can also do that by making a slight curve in the bottom part of your spinal cord. Got to help to align all the other areas of your spinal cord and drop your neck a little. Some of the exercises that have been offered to our classes through Brother Saladin, who's a martial arts teacher, all help enhance the energy that flows throughout your spinal cord, to your nervous system, and to your glands. What you can begin to do is to breathe deep, because a lot of us are not aware of our breathing rhythms, how shallow they are, how much they're basically are trapped up into the upper part of your lung cage. You also have the dorsal area of your breathing mechanism. You also have the bottom part, which is diaphragmatic. So you have to breathe down more and fill up your lungs to the top.
If I can just
yes.
For a second. Now, where can these youth get some information regarding what you're talking about?
Right here. Right here. And as we begin to do a little bit more research on the imports of melanin, because even like this pamphlet, this handout that was given to us today by the elders has a lot of information on it, on terms of the enzymes that are released and the different gland areas that they release from. Now, if we could just go to the library here, we could start to realize, or we could start to research where the glands are located, and just knowing where they're located, being able to identify their location helps you to become more aware of it during the day. It's not to be so much distracted by the outer difficulties and conflicts that we've been talking about, but to try to internalize some type of information that can help us with our health. Because it doesn't make a difference whether we black or light skinned. I mean, if we all are coughing and AIDS ridden, which is another import, they're saying that a lot of diseases that are made in laboratories are specially designed to link to your melanin. You know, a lot of the drugs that are produced in areas of the world that are flushed into the communities are made to link to your melanin. So our best defense could right now become our worst undoing. It's the fact that we all black could spell out doom, because it's very hard to flush out these different type of chemicals, you know, that we accumulate through eating different type of foods that are not traditionally African and that can't even be digested, such as milk and a lot of fats and a lot of different type of meats, for the most part can't be digested by your systems. Because African people traditionally are fruit eaters, they ate meat, but ate meat as a side dish, not as a main course. And these things, I mean, just to clean out your body and fasting and drinking a lot more water, trying to definitely not to drink any type of chemical solutions. That take care of beer and all the other stuff, period, that y'all experimenting with. You know, the sodas, the cigarettes and the drugs and things of that nature. But there's a lot of drugs that we are not aware of that's in our mayonnaise and peanut butter and jelly and breads. So you have to do a lot more research on nutrition. You know, there's a lot of people here that are of the Muslim faith that can help us a lot with that information provided, you know, through the Nation of Islam and a lot of different other sects of the Islamic faith. You know, being that there's a lot of information around about Malcolm X, that should help us to delve into those areas also. Okay. But there's a lot of people in here that can help us with that.
Well, I'm not going to, you know, keep you long, but I think some of these kids would like to ask you some questions later on if you can make yourself available.
College. And before I forget, I think the youth need to listen to what that brother said first. The first thing he said, he asked the elders to speak. And that is a form of respect that we need to learn that is not being taught in the majority of society today. And after hearing him, I don't even deserve to sit here, but, you know. I just want to make a couple comments because I know time is running short. I'm as light as y'all going to see at being black. And the point that is not being pushed enough is it is not only your skin color, it's a frame of mind. Being black is what you have inside of you. Because I've heard it all growing up. Oreo cookie, you know, the cream color on the outside, and the chocolate color on the inside, all kinds of little jokes, even when I came here to McGavers College. You know, when I came here, this school only had 2,000 students. I was the lightest guy in here. And I got involved in what was going on, and they said, who's this white guy running up and down the halls telling us to unite and get together? And it's funny, no, it was funny, but now I educated them that it's not only my skin color, and no one will come up to me and dare ask me that question again. And that is what you need to do as children. You need to have self-confidence in yourself. Go out and say, I'm black, I'm proud, and I'm going to make something out of myself. That is the key. Don't listen, don't go out there, don't listen to the guys in the corner, take a little toke of this, take a little sip of this. All they're trying to do is oppress you and keep you down. So they don't like to see you making something out of yourself because it makes them feel that much lower.
I just have a question now. You said that you received ridicule due to your skin color. Have you been able to use that as a boon or some type of aid to get across whatever it is you're trying to get across, or is it still something that's a detriment to you?
I don't let it be a detriment to me.
Right.
I don't allow it to be. I am who I am.
Right.
And if you like me hard, if you don't like me, hey, that's too bad. But I'm gonna say what I have to say, and hopefully people will listen and understand and learn. Because we're not educating our youth. Just like that brother, you know, that brother laughed, and we jumped at him when he laughed, but we shouldn't have. It was not his fault.
No.
That's what he was taught. And we need to, instead of sitting there and saying, look, you're wrong, tell him why he is wrong.
Excuse me,
yes.
I'm his teacher, okay? And I don't allow anyone in class to laugh at each other. None of us are perfect. And as a class and as a group, we have to be supportive of each other. And Swami knows this, okay? He knows what it was like for him having an accent. He knows what it was like for him to be teased because of his hair. So he should be the last person to point fingers.
Right, I don't think he's trying to...
I'm not,
the young man is wrong.
Right.
He's just trying to say that when we meld with other people, we seem to forget some things that we used to experience that we didn't like. Now, he might go home and remember that, hey, when I came up here, people were saying, boy, you sound funny, you can't even speak proper
exactly.
English. But now, while in the midst of his friends, sometimes we lose just who we are and where we are. It was just a slip. He's not trying to say that the brother's going to go around
right.
Doing that. As soon as he leaves here, he's going to make fun of people.
No, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying, when you said about
no, I'm not speaking as you, because you are his teacher. You are his parent away from home. And if we had enough sisters like you to stand up and teach our children, we wouldn't be having these problems. But what I'm just saying is I heard a little snickering from even the students here at the college. And then, you know, they were looking at the little narrow light instead of thinking, maybe why did he say this? And my last comment is, my whole problem with this is there's too many empty seats. Our junior high schools, our elementary schools should fill this place. This is an African-American college. This is a black college, and I see a handful of students from the college here. And that is my problem, not even a handful, and some of them only here because we're required to be here. And I have a major problem with that. And you know, the junior high school, Jackie Robinson, should be here in full force.
So whatever masses are here now, we're going to charge you to take what you've heard here, toss it around in your mind, take the positives and try to spread it around so everyone knows.
Can I just say,
I just wanted to comment to Bill because he's right that the seats ought to be full.
Yeah.
But they were about an hour ago.
Yes.
If anybody was here for the children's program, I have to take responsibility for that because I sent out the letters. And the auditorium was full at 9:30, but the children had to go. Now, perhaps this particular time slot is hard for some schools because they have to go back for lunch. So I have to kind of get them here in the morning, but his point is well taken. I know he wasn't here for the children's program, but it was a delightful program. I think the children enjoyed it, and the auditorium was absolutely full. And I'm really happy these children came in a little late, and I'm happy that they did, because at least they are here now. Otherwise, they may also be gone along with the other children. But you are absolutely right. I just wanted to explain with the school situation that the timing of the program make a difference. They were here this morning.
Thank you very much.
Yes. Thank you. I don't want to belabor the point, and I don't think there needs anyone to speak, you know, in his behalf to defend him. It's not an indictment of those that are here. It's the fact that a lot of people, because I've worked with Dr. Rock and on this conference in the past, and a lot of people don't know what melanin is, and they're not aware of how it relates to them. Because I know, you know, when I worked in the past with registration, there were students that didn't want to come in. They came in because their professors asked them to, or they were required to. But after they left, they were like hungry for more information. And the thing is that a lot of us aren't aware. So it's really not an indictment of the people that are here. See, that's all I wanted to say.
Express anything?
First of all, I'd say good afternoon to all. My name is Tracy. I attend Sandy Purchase College in Westchester. But before I came to New York, I was living in North Carolina. I was born in 1970, so you could imagine racism was going on still then. And we used to have to take a yellow bus to school. And the bus went through different zones of our community. They picked up the whites first, then they picked up the Negroes, so that's what they called us then. And as we got on the bus, they used to count off one little two, little three, little niggas. Now, me being a child back in those days, I couldn't understand why they did that to us. And it was kind of strange because we used to all run to the back of the bus. So that's why they used to keep us in the back of the bus. Then when I came to New York, it was hard to distinguish whites because everyone, I mean, you got your Puerto Ricans, you got your Dominicans, everybody was together, sort of. Kind of, you know, so that's what I'm saying is, being from the South, it's a different outlook on how things are, because when it gets dark, everyone's inside. You know, out here in New York, the lights are on, it looks sort of like day. So what I'm saying to you is, I went to my father and I asked him, why do they do these things to us? And he said, well, the word nigger means an ignorant individual, doesn't mean your skin color. Anyone could be a nigger. You understand? Not just because we're not black, we're brown. So that's a name that they gave us. Oh, look at this black person. Well, someone came to me and said, well, you're black. I said, no, I'm brown and I'm proud of it. And another thing is, a lot of us young brothers, we have the wrong role models. A perfect role model to me is not a guy in the corner selling drugs who can push around everybody. You know, to me, that's not a role model. And a lot of our guys look up to these guys who are on the corners, like the brother said, smoking these blunts and drinking these, that's not the way. I look up more to someone who goes to church with the tight pants on,
who's trying to be someone in life, striving to be successful. And people look at you differently when you're in a position where you can say and speak as you feel. So I just want to say to young folks, you know, don't get down if someone says to you, oh, you're a nigger or you're this. You look at them and say, well, you're a nigger because you're ignorant for calling me a nigger, because I have just as much respect and pride for myself as you. Don't let these clothes and these sneakers and these things get in the way just because someone is less fortunate than you, because that's another thing that we are focusing on. School's not all about getting clothes, and it's about education. That's what you must focus on, getting your education. It sounds strange because, see, when, I can't say that because, see, when I was in your spot, I thought of it as the same. See, I'm speaking from experience because I went through it. I had to go, yes, sir.
Sorry, let me ask you a question. You said you came from North Carolina.
Yes, sir.
Now, you're lighter than I am. That's going to be distinguishable as soon as you step next to me.
Yes, sir.
Did you receive any type of favoritism or animosity?
Yes, I did. My brother is the same exact complexion as you are. Even in my family, which is sick to say, they distinguish the darker side to the darker side. And this is the honest truth, because this is things that have to be discussed. Just because I was lighter, they said, well, you hang out with that on. And my brother, who is much darker than I, he tended to stray away because he thought because he was darker, he wasn't supposed to be there. And I didn't think that was right. But these are things that happen in life and have to be discussed to the younger ones so that we can understand. And you can't speak to someone if you don't know from experience. You have to go through it and have to come to you in open mind, open heart, and actually tell you what it's like. And like his brother said, being darker does not make you better. They say the sweeter, the darker, the same they have. It's a bunch of garbage. It's hogwash, you know. And they even come to the extent where they say, well, you get coffee and it's dark, and you add cream to it and make it weak. I mean, it's good to say that because that's what Malcolm X said. But all that matters is how you feel about yourself. If you feel that you're happy with yourself the way you are, I think you'll go a whole lot further. You got to see about yourself first before you can. Before I can talk about her or talk about her or him, I have to know about myself first, and then you begin to strive in life. That's all I have to say. I have to say thank you for letting me speak.
We're taking last comments. If anyone has any other things they'd like to share with us.
Don't say, oh, I did a good deed, I went to this wellness symposium and I listened to all this stuff. You know, don't feel like, okay, I did good. You know, take it further. Don't let it end when you walk out of this auditorium. For my kids, you know I'm not going to let it end. Probably going to be going through this for a lot longer. You know, we're going to do follow through, you know, follow up lessons and discussions. And it's just something that you have to delve into and find out and reach an understanding for yourself. Because I cannot leave here and say, oh, I understand so much better now. No, I'm more confused now. So now I have to, you know, get rid of some of my confusion, help my students get rid of some of theirs, and that we should all be doing that as well.
Just to add to what she said, from what you've heard today, I'm sure quite a few of you have a whole lot of questions we didn't even touch on, but that's the whole point of it. Once you start asking questions, then you can go about finding the answers. So don't be afraid to ask the questions. If you're going to be sincere about asking the questions and sincere about trying to get the answers, you're going to get what you want.
I think that the time is keynote speaker this evening, Dr. Richard King, who has quite a reputation in the field of melanin. In addition to the one-day symposium that we sponsored during Black History Month, we've also exposed some of the students in the college in our college-wide honors program. We've given a full semester's discussion on the topic of melanin. And based on the feedback that we've gotten from our honors students, I think that they feel that they gain quite a lot from the discussions of melanin. I understand that this morning's student roundtable discussion was a very interesting session in that the audience had many, many questions. And I'm sure that after you've heard our presentations and discussions, that you will go away with some added knowledge on the topic of melanin. Before we get into this session's discussion, let me first of all introduce the faculty that will participate in the roundtable and also say a word about how we will proceed. To my far right, Dr. Aola Thompson, who has been with us from the very beginning, and she has a very interesting discussion that she does on melanin that's related to her field, which is physical education. Dr. Thompson. Next to her is that person that gave quite an outstanding keynote presentation last year, Dr. Ann Brown. To my far left, and I will introduce her before we go into today's proceeding. So I'll skip her for a moment. Next to her is Dr. Sheila Myers Johnson. In having us give our melanin workshop to the honors students. As many of you know, she's the director of the college-wide honors program. And to my immediate left, I would certainly have to say that she's the mother of our melanin activities, because she's the person who has organized us, who has pushed us to maintain our focus and to provide the one-day symposium. Johnson. I'm a member of the chemistry faculty, and I've been fortunate enough to have been with the Melanin Committee over the past 5 years. The person that I would ask to come to the microphone or pick up her microphone and tell you a little bit about what happened this morning, perhaps some of the purpose and how it was received, because I believe this is her third year's involvement in providing a melanin presentation for our youth. We had children here from elementary schools, junior high school, 500 in fact, we had the auditorium filled, so that they could get some information on melanin. She's also one of ours, she's a graduate of Medgar's College, and we're indeed very, very proud to see her take up the mantle and provide the kind of presentations that she has, Ms. MBK Anderson.
Thank you. I have been really excited because before this distinguished panel asked me to write something for the children, I was in the dark just like most of you were. And when the call came and said, BK, can you do a show for students? Because my professional background is dance and storytelling, and I've been doing storytelling for over 25, 27 years now. My oldest is 30? Yeah, more than 30 years. Yeah. And so talking comes naturally to me, but I felt that a program for the children should have children involved. So I went to my friend in District 16, Richard Barcliff, the artist. If you're any part of the dance world, you know his work. And I said, Richard, how can we make this more valuable to the students? And he says, well, give us an idea of what you want us to do. I said, well, we're going to look at the question of melanin. And the first year, we struck out to inform people about melanin, inform the little people about melanin. I ran to the dictionary when I got the call, and the only thing that it informed me of was it had something to do with skin cancer and making you black. I said, well, I'm glad to be black, and I don't want skin cancer, so I don't think either one of those subjects are worth writing about. Then the information came to me, the articles, the little mini conferences I had with Dr. Johnson on the different points that she felt children would be interested in. And I said, you know what, if we told this to the students, let's see what they would come up with. And when my first meeting with the students, and I said, well, we're going to do a play, and they said, well, where's the script? I said, you are the script. We want to bring the students real experiences. While we were practicing different skits based on just discovering who you are and what you're about, taking them all the way back to Africa, and how the lifestyle there was very conducive to all the rhythmic vibrations and strong calculations and the athletic power beyond compare, we brought it back here to see the diversity in our people. For whatever reasons, we see a broad spectrum of the beautiful brown chocolate that we are, and it's real, it's here, and we deal with it. But melanin is much more important than that. So this year, we started focusing on the inward and the spiritual and the attitude. And it was so funny, the piece that we did on nigger this morning was very, very timely because one of the teachers says she has her students write an essay if they use the word, because 9 times out of 10, our students bandy this word about and have no idea the implications of it. So we brought that. The attitude piece that the girls developed came out of the second year that the students participated in the conference show. A real incident happened in the schoolyard, and it was so funny because the sister who said it was of a lighter hue. But somebody called her the black word, and she says, yeah, honey, I can do that because I'm sufficiently melanized. And that was the term we had used for the first conference. Sufficiently and deficiently melanized. And I said, yeah, this works. Empower them. So what we do, we've developed a superhero because Lord knows our children need to be aware of their melanin, but they also need heroes and heroines of their own hue. You know? So the first year, we said we needed a symbol for our conference, and one of the students developed I said, well, if Melanin Man would come around and tell people that you're black and beautiful, what would you feel? And I said, we feel good. I said, well, what does Melanin Man look like? And he drew a picture of this guy with a cape and red flashing. And I said, okay, which one of you students want to be Melanin Man? Nobody volunteered for the job. And I sure could get Richard to wear tight. So I became Melina, the griot of the Melanin Megaforce. I began to tell the story, and that's what happens. We take the individual skins and we weave them together. I create some rap poems for the transitions. And we do it. just as if the students were just sitting down and talking about it, and we dramatize the little situations that come up in their life. So far we've got studying and basketball. We made a parallel between the two because most students don't realize how quickly melanin allows you to calculate. So we do a basketball sketch to show them how they use their physics, how they deal with their thinking skills on such a quick basis. Then we went and paired negative attitudes, because it also is very important for them to know that their body is really sacred. And melanin accentuates everything, including the negative. So if you put drugs in your body, the reaction you get from those drugs are going to be much stronger than somebody who's not as sufficiently melanized as we are. So get them to realize that they have to look and stop and think about what they do. I've enjoyed being part of it, and I don't know what we're going to come up with next year. Well, we're thinking about it now. We started yesterday in thinking about the skits for next year. Also, I empowered the teachers that came to the program this morning to start doing these little skits in their classrooms. Doesn't always have to take an assembly program or a stage program, but this is a way to foster their language arts skills, their thinking skills, and to be able to get them to realize that their opinions are important. I'm working with high school students now on a drug prevention program co-sponsored by LEAP, the organization that I'm with, and NYU. They're trying to develop resiliency skills in high school students, and it amazes me how little they think their opinion is valid, and so they don't want to give it. So we have to start from kindergarten now, allowing children to give their opinions and not looking to the adults to say, well, what do you want me to say? So the word is activate your melanin state.
Thank you.
Thank you, MBK. Can you imagine that when you were 10, 11, and 12, had you heard of the word melanin? No, I doubt it. So you can gather the kind of impact that MBK is making. That, as I mentioned a moment ago, we had 500 young people in here this morning. They know the word melanin. And of course, over the years, their curiosity will lead them to discover much, much more. Even though the educational process is not likely to have much to say, but because they've come here, they've gotten excited, and I've seen young people several months later, after they've been here, they sometimes tease me and call me the watermelon man, but they know that word, and they have some idea of what melanin is about. And indeed, this is one of the things that we feel very proud about. Because again, you are witnessing something that is rather distinct. There is nowhere else in this country where you can go and participate and hear such discussions as we provide on melanin. Again, outside of the national symposium that is held each year in various cities throughout the country, we're perhaps the only other source where a forum is provided for really thorough discussions and presentations on melanin. Now, let me just sort of mention how we're going to proceed in this session. As you noted, this is going to be a faculty roundtable discussion. So you're sort of going to be looking in as some questions are raised about melanin. And I trust that when it's over, you should have some additional information about melanin that you now perhaps might not know. But before I begin, let me make an announcement. From the last session, a student left a bag, a handbag on one of the seats. And if anyone should notice a bag, would you please turn it in to the security office? Now, we have, as you notice, an empty chair, or perhaps there are two empty chairs on the stage. As questions are raised and we go into our responses, if any of you feel that there's an item that you would like to have brought into the discussion, you can come and take one of the empty chairs. And you will be given an opportunity to raise your question. So instead of the usual format where presentations are made and then at the end people are allowed to raise questions, you can raise them at any point throughout this session. So anyone, please feel free to come up and take a chair, and you will be given the opportunity. Because I know that sometimes you want to raise a question when it's somewhat close to what's being discussed, as opposed to waiting until the end. So you can have the opportunity to come up and join us. I'm going to start the discussion by raising the following question. Most people, when you hear the word melanin, what immediately comes to your mind is a skin pigment. And I would dare say that most folks tend to think that that's the extent of melanin, that somehow or another it's in the skin. And what I would like to do for the panel is to ask, and perhaps Dr. Ann Brown might want to be the first respondent, where is melanin found in the human body?
Hotep, everyone. Or good afternoon. The question was raised, where would one find melanin in the body? And my answer, just to start off the discussion, would be it's found everywhere. The melanin that you see that has color is a skin-type melanin. But melanin itself, as a chemical molecule or chemistry, is found in all cells or organs or tissues. In fact, some recent studies have shown that it's in the middle ear by the eardrum, and of course it's in the inner ear, the highly melanized area that you probably have seen every time you look at the mirror is the iris of your eye. That has a very, very deep concentration of melanin, being black and brown and other shades. The inner core, you call the pupil, that very narrow opening in your eye, is really a window that is reflecting the melanin in the back of your eye. So you have melanized cells back there. And the reason why you need it in these strategic locations is because those areas are where light depend on light for light energy. So melanin being a molecule, it is going to conduct or transduce light waves and light energy so that you can utilize it and use it for the body for various purposes. So it is black simply because it is efficient, meaning that it absorbs the rays of transmutation sunlight, any kind of light. It absorbs that light 100%. And other colors that you don't see, that you do see, only absorb part of the light energy and reflect the others. But black itself, this jacket I'm wearing and other people who are wearing dark colors, The light rays and the light energy is absorbed 100% into those items. Therefore, I'm saying that there are areas in the body where melanin is most highly concentrated because of a functional reason. So my answer would be that it is all over the body and darker on the outside in certain deep centers in the brain for a functional reason.
Dr. Brown, I just said, when you mentioned the melanin, the iris, are you really saying that eyes that are blue or green or gray or whatever are really eyes where there's a lack of melanin and that these colors are not pigment as such, but represent the absence of melanin? Are you saying that?
Not really. Everybody has the pupil, which is the central portion of the eye, dark, no matter what the race or the shade. But the iris itself reflects a functional type of structure. There is melanite cells there are cells in the iris that are melanized, but it's not black melanin. The blue, gray, and hazel eyes originally were for the purpose of tunnel vision. That is, if you're in the dark, in the ice, in the cave, you have no need for peripheral vision. Your food gathering and your other daily activities are limited. Whereas people from tropical Africa originally need the kind of vision that they can see from all angles. So thus the dark brown to black iris coloration.
You made another point when you talked about melanin being all through the body, but there being certain areas of the body where there are higher concentrations. And a psychologist by the name of Joseph Chilton Pierce has done a good deal of focusing on children's development and the presence of melanin in certain areas of the brain and its relationship to the bonding in the relationship between mother and child. He talked about the high concentrations of melanin in the brain and in the heart. And an example that he gives in a work that he's written, he says, take an example of two heart molecules which have two heart cells rather, which have high concentrations of melanin. Put them on a slide, separate them, and they will throb as a heartbeat. So these heart cells will throb, but move the cells closer together, not necessarily touching, but closer together, and they will begin to beat rhythmically in unison. And what he says is that high concentration of melanin in the heart and brain is part of that communication that takes place, that felt communication between mother and child. And I think it's a wonderful metaphor both for the concentration and the importance and the implications for behavior.
Okay, so the first thing I think that you can realize from this is that melanin is not only found in the skin. As the speakers mentioned, it's located throughout the body. It's in our blood cells, it's in the brain, and we know very much that when a person is somehow or another deficient in producing melanin that's found in the brain, it leads to some sort of disease state. One of the most common ones is Parkinson. And we know that when the substantia nigra is somehow not being produced as it should, it leads to a neurological disorder. So the inference to the scientists is that melanin that's in the brain, and they've located about six centers in the brain in which there are significant concentrations of melanin, that melanin is there to provide neuronal transmission. In other words, impulses through the nerves. Of course, the nervous system, the spinal cord, has quite a lot of melanin. There's an adage that nature does not put anything in us unless there's a function, a purpose. And so if you analyze the human body and and you find that there's quite a lot in the heart, there's quite a lot in the liver, the kidneys, there's quite a lot of melanin in the brain and the nervous system, then it must mean that somehow or another, in the function of those organs, melanin has a role at some point. And that is indeed one of the areas in which people are trying to do research to try and define what is the role of melanin in those locations. So certainly we feel that the full story has not been told, because we realize that it's not just in the skin. In fact, some people have said that only about a very small percentage of your body melanin is in the skin. And most people would tend to think that that's about where all the melanin is. But that's only a very small percentage of the melanin.
You know, you mentioned something about Parkinson's, and for those who are members of the audience who are also members of my classes, forgive me for repeating this, I know you've heard it before, but there's an anecdote that I'd like to share that I think is significant, especially because we started out trying to convey to children the importance of melanin in our bodies and the attitude that we often develop because of misinformation and socially imposed stereotypes and so on. Earlier we've had a videotape going of Francis Kress Welsing at one of the National Melanin Conferences. Some years ago there was a videotaped discussion, dialogue between Francis Kress Welsing and William Shockley. William Shockley was one of the psychologists in the late 60s, early 70s, who came forward with the idea that black people, people of color, are inherently, that is to say, genetically inferior in intelligence. So Tony Brown's journal had a conversation between the two of them with Francis Kress Welsing putting forth her theory of color confrontation, and William Shockley arguing that people of color, and he had statistics to show how on standardized tests of intelligence we demonstrate inferior levels of performance. Francis Kress Welsing argued the side of the coin that said those are culturally biased tests, and the other part of what William Shockley was arguing was that given that according to statistics, people of color demonstrate lower levels of performance on IQ tests, that we should do some genetic screening so people of color don't do as much producing and generating such inferiority in the gene pool. What Francis Kress Welsing argued was that if we were to follow your idea, we would wind up, Caucasian people would be wiped out very quickly because people of color, or Caucasian people, are much more susceptible to genetically born disease. And so if you wanted to weed out deficiencies, Caucasian people would be weeded out much earlier. The irony behind that is that this particular program was aired in 75, originally. It was taped originally in 75. It was re-aired in 90. And when I saw it at that particular time, I was aware that William Shockley himself had Parkinson's disease, a melanin-related disease. He subsequently died from Parkinson's a year or so ago. Bottom line was that if he had the power to implement his decision, or such a decision had been implemented, he wouldn't have been here to put it forth, because his line would have been bred out of existence, because he carried a trait that was melanin-related that led to this deficiency, and Parkinson's winds up, because of melanin's presence in the nervous system, Parkinson's is expressed in the form of tremors and spasms, lack of muscular control. So it's sort of ironic in terms of the relationship between its physiology and the attitude that's put forth.
I'm going to break procedure for a moment. There's a young man who wants to raise a question, but he doesn't want to come forward. So I'll just reach over here and allow him to ask his question.
What exactly is melanin?
Keep asking.
He's asking, what exactly is melanin? Well, we like to say it's a biopigment. Now, that doesn't give the full answer. We normally have a picture of the molecule that
we
have up on the screen, but we don't have that here today. Chemically, we have a reasonably good understanding of what melanin is, even though there is some debate on the exact structure. For instance, you cannot say that melanin is a protein, cannot say it's a carbohydrate, cannot say it's a lipid. Melanin seems to have all of the components of those biomolecules. It has functional groups that you find in proteins, functional groups that you find in carbohydrates, functional groups that you find in lipids. Melanin certainly, from a chemist's point of view, if a chemist were to be asked, design a molecule that would be an excellent receptor of energy, whether that energy is sound, light, heat, or any other various forms of electromagnetic spectrum, they would probably come up with a molecule that looks very much like melanin. It has what we call a lot of functional groups. Functional groups are those parts of the molecule that give the molecule its characteristics, which determine that molecule's behavior. For instance, if you're talking proteins, you'll say it's the peptide bonds, the C double bond O N H, just to use some words. But anyway, the way we talk, we're saying it's those particular groups of atoms that define the behavior of your proteins. Well, again, melanin has those kinds of groups as well. Because it has so many functional groups, melanin can be involved in a very wide variety of biochemical reactions in the body. There is no other molecule quite like it. Whether you're looking at hemoglobin, whether you're looking at the hormones, whether you're looking at the enzymes, whether you're looking at even the genetic material, DNA, melanin is a much more diverse molecule to the chemist than any of those. So the best that I can tell you in terms of what is melanin, it's a biopigment, meaning it has a rather high molecular weight. In other words, it's very heavy. When you compare it to the weight of, let's say, alcohol, which we call ethanol, it is such a complex molecule that in the next question that I was going to ask, why is it that we don't know more about melanin? Well, I'll answer my own question. since you sort of short-circuited by asking. It has to do with the fact that in terms of how chemists work out the structure of compounds, they have to be able to take these compounds and dissolve them in some solution. They have to be able to get these compounds to react with an acid or a base. Well, we are unable to do that with melanin. Melanin is resistant to most of the kinds of chemical procedures that we put molecules through so that we can put them in an instrument and study their structure. Now, we can do that to some extent so that we are able to get some information in terms of what melanin looks like. But because melanin is so sturdy, we're unable to study it in a manner that we do with most other molecules. And people who are chemists, molecular biologists, they're trying to figure out ways in which to study the melanin molecule. So inherently, the nature of the molecule makes it difficult to study. But there are some other reasons as well. For instance, until very recently, most people thought melanin that you didn't see in the skin, that if you found it anywhere in the body, it was a so-called neurological waste material. That the melanin that was seen inside of the body, that somehow or another it was a metabolic waste product. The world is not too interested in studying waste material. So they put melanin into that category and just simply ignored it and say that, you know, it's there because it's a waste material and the body hasn't completely got rid of it, and somehow or another some of it got caught in the brain, somehow or another some of it got caught in the nervous system and all of these other organs of the body. So that was used as a reason as to why there wasn't very much done on melanin, because it was supposed to be such an uninteresting molecule. Does anyone else have anything that you would like to offer to that?
Yes, I just want to add too that although we are hearing some of this for the first time, and for me it was about 5 years ago that I understood much at all about melanin, I think we should all be aware that there has been a great deal of research going on for years. I would say 40 or 50 years. There has been research going on, and primarily in Europe, because once I began to realize that I had spent a lifetime in the health profession, and all of a sudden being exposed to the idea that there was a biological feature called melanin that I had hardly heard of, and I had all these degrees in nursing and health education, I began to go to the literature, and I found out that there have been at least 47 annual conferences on melanin, most of which have been held in Europe, and there is lots and lots and lots of research material. It's highly technical material. It's not the kind of material that you would just pick up and read and feel well informed. And you might be interested to know that on the table outside, there is a document that lists 40 or 50 references. And so that you can certainly get some of those references and look them up in the library, but they're not published for lay reading. They're published for scientists so that the actual information is well known to an international body of scientists. But we're just beginning to get the information, probably for some of the reasons Dr. Johnson mentioned, or their political reasons, I'm sure. And another reason we're just getting it, because people who have sufficient or are highly melanated, such as ourselves, are the ones who are the most interested, I guess. So we're the ones who are making other people aware of it. And it's so indestructible that one historian, Sheikh Anzal Diop, has mentioned that you find it in the mummies, in the remains of Egyptian mummies. And from his point of view, that solves the question as to the skin color of the ancient pharaohs of Egypt. You can find melanin there in their presence.
Dr. Walker, Dr. Johnson, I'd like to ask this question because I've heard this on three or four different occasions. If the melanin molecule is as hard to break down as you say, and this has come up in the discussion of skin cancer, they're trying to replicate it and artificially produce it. Is this true?
Yes, it is true. And let me just say that a few years ago, in fact, we have an article outside. In the Wall Street Journal, they had a topic on genetic engineering. One of the problems today is skin cancer. It's supposed to be the fastest growing cancer on the planet. We hear things on public service announcements about not going out in the sun too long, that you're supposed to go out there for a certain length of time and leave it. Now, you didn't hear those kinds of announcements 5 years ago. Why do you hear them now every summer when it gets warm?
because people are very concerned about getting cancer from the sun. Now, what's being done? The scientific world, because they look and say, wait a minute, those people that have melanin, they don't seem to get this skin cancer. And it's the fastest growing cancer on the planet. It means that somehow or another this melanin is providing some protection. What they are trying to do is to, and it shows you how people think. There's a lot less cigarette smoking in this country. The tobacco farmers are wondering what are they going to do with their crops in the future. Well, what the scientist is trying to do is to get tobacco plants to grow melanin. In other words, they're using genetic engineering. They're going to change the genes around in the tobacco plant. You know, I have to take those genes that we have that allows us to make melanin, put those genes in tobacco, and have the tobacco to make melanin. And then they will take that melanin, put it in a cream. Now, the reason why that article was put in the Wall Street Journal was because they were telling people who have money, and a lot of the people that read the Wall Street Journal are those folks that have, quote, discretionary funds, that you better take your money and put it over here, because this is going to be a big seller. They say that it's going to be the largest single selling item on the planet when they get it developed. So what they're doing is they're not trying to, like a chemist, go into the laboratory and build a molecule. They're trying to get natural things like plants, because they're able to take, let's say, a human gene and take that gene and put it into a plant and get that plant to make that particular molecule the same as a human body would. That's part of what people do in genetic engineering. So they're going to try to get the natural plant by inserting the appropriate gene in it to make melanin. And so they're pretty much on the way. They have that part of the experiment pretty well worked out. The part that they're having difficulty with is in compounding the cream, because the melanin seems to clump up and it won't spread evenly. So it's a engineering problem, if you will, at this point. But you'll probably see down the road that the types of sunscreens they have now, they are ineffective. They don't really work. So they're trying to get nature's arm, which is melanin, to protect people against the sun. I saw an advertisement in another paper a few years ago where they were extolling the virtues, the fact that you would be able to get this tan by just simply rubbing this cream on it. And they were saying what was so great about it, that you would not have the bra and panty lines, that you can just put the cream on you, and based on how much you apply, would determine the intensity of your tan. And so they're working on that as we sit here, trying to duplicate what melanated people can do naturally. They're going to try to use the technology to make a cream with melanin in it, and that melanin was produced through a natural process, being the tobacco plants. And that way, if a non-melanated person say, okay, you think you have an advantage because you have melanin, that's all right. I can go to the store and buy a cream, and I'll have the same thing you got. And that's the way the work seems to be going.
You know, there's, I think, some important implications. Question that you raised with regard to why don't we know more about melanin, and I think there are at least two parts of that. One, as you say, because it's so difficult to study, but also, as you implied by the discussion also, the attitude on the part of scientists in terms of how they perceived it, and the extent to which they choose to do research on melanin, or how they interpret what is done. There's a book that came to our attention recently. What's Ashley Robbins' book, Biological Aspects of Human Pigmentation? In that, they talk about, biological perspectives on human pigmentation. And I need to find the exact quote in here, but they looked at evidence of relationship between skin color and psychiatric disorder, mental disorder. And at one point, many years back, many psychiatrists speculated that people of color were more subject to psychiatric disorder. After years of research, they had to, as they say, debunk that theory. And somewhere in here, I'll find it before we break, Robin says that, he quotes Orwell saying that sometimes it's a beautiful theory, but you have to dismiss it in the face of evidence. So he's saying that they really wanted to believe that more melanated people were more subject to mental disorder, but alas, in the face of evidence, they had to let go of the theory. And on that, along those same lines, what makes it so critical, when we ran the melanin seminar from honor students, we had our valedictorian for 1990 was a member of the class, and she was a member of she was a nursing major, and she expressed a great deal of frustration. She said, how is it that I am graduating as a nursing major and just beginning to be exposed to all of this very critical information? Because what we were talking about are implications that impact very dramatically on the medications that you are given, for example. Our bodies respond differently. And for example, psychotropic drugs, the drugs on the street like cocaine and heroin and the like, bind melanin, but not only the ones on the street, the ones that are used in medication of mental illness. They bind to melanin, some of which produce Parkinson's-like symptoms, for example. So there are a variety of issues related to the very different biochemistry and the medication that is used. That another member of that melanin seminar had formerly worked as a psychiatric nurse, and she said, now that we're talking about it, I remember that sometimes when patients were medicated, they became darker. Melanin had been activated.
I just wanted to add that the young lady that you're speaking of is not only just a nursing student, but she was in the nursing bachelor's degree program, the BS program, so this person is already an RN. And her frustration was at the fact that she's gone through all of these nursing courses and now she's getting a BS degree in nursing. And out of all her years of training, there's nothing in the books, nothing in the literature that addresses these aspects of melanin as it applies even to from the biological standpoint. And so we know that from the biological standpoint, there are a lot of factors that concern melanin, but the textbooks do not have them. The research has not come down, that is, to this level.
It's interesting that there's a comment in this book that says that actually that an international community of scientists has decided or made the statement that melanin ranks next to the red blood cell and the neuron in terms of biological significance. I mean, that's a statement that just blows my mind.
Can I just repeat that? Can you imagine a group of reputable scientists saying that melanin is as important as hemoglobin, or nearly so? But yet, all of the textbooks that we use in our science classes, you don't find anything on melanin, hardly. Almost nothing. It's rather striking. But yet, if you study the melanin molecule as our honor students did, and you talk about these functions that the melanin is involved in inside the body, it is really mind-boggling that you can't find more than a paragraph of material hardly on melanin. And then